You see this balloon here? This blue balloon? Well, I had just made this commitment, spiritual commitment, and I walked here to do the tape, to the taping, and this balloon was sitting right here on the pathway. It's extraordinary. Don't know where it came from. It just floated in from somewhere. And I was focusing on the color blue as representing dark blue, deep blue Krishna, Samantabhadra. The color of divinity, of God, is this dark, dark blue, and this is what this is. And then, so here this beautiful star just showed up. As I just saw it, and I just said, oh my gosh, how extraordinary. And how it possibly got here, it'd have to go through all sorts of, you know, bends and curves and stuff. And it was just sitting right there, right where I walk here to tape. So you talk about synchronicity. You can't write this stuff like script it. It's like a movie someone would script it, but actually happened. So that this, what happens to with me, is real. I don't make it up, but I don't say everything that happens because people say, well, he's just making it up. The synchronicities are just so extraordinary. They really are. I just have to laugh. I say, oh, nobody's going to believe that. You know, why even bother telling them, right? That's right. So, one moment, please. So it's not easy to for me to tape because my life is so extraordinary that people just, you know, not going to believe it. This is a problem you run into. What can you do? You just keep on going, and it is what it is. So I've been spending time on Facebook, a lot of time on Facebook, just to see what is Facebook really like. I know what Facebook's like now. Okay, so it is what it is. But like everywhere, everybody's missing it, of course. Of course. Our goal, the dance of continuity fear, is to prevent us from whatever we want to call it. Abidance. The spirit of abidance is to prevent that and to fail. To fail to reach our true goal. That's the whole idea of continuity fear, the dance of continuity fear. And so what we do is we fail. You know, that's what we do. And we dress failure up. And so we just dress failure up. That's what's been going on in this world and will continue to go on. Most are engaged in that, how to dress failure up in a nice spiritual costume. That's the bottom line, isn't it? It's not about trying and spirituality and stuff. It's about success, reaching the goal. Abidance, the spirit of abidance is really the goal. Not just glimpsing abidance, but having the spirit of abidance, that's the goal. And very few accept this. So they fail. And we dress failure up. So Facebook is, there's a lot of, it's a big costume party, dressing failure up, basically. I mean, if you know, you get out of it what you put into it. You can get help and pointers and such. But if you don't know how to manage your success, you're just going to spin your wheels and stall out. So the path has to be rapid. The path has to feel like you're changing the landscape of your expectations every day. St. Paul said, "I die daily." This is what we must do. Change the landscape of our expectations every single day. So I'm trying and working on that today. I have an affirmation. Remember, ask, receive, practice. Petition, receive, practice. PRPs. Mind your PRPs. Ask in the morning, what's the practice for today? Grace of God, Holy Spirit, and Guru. And then practice that. And I have a practice for today and have been doing it. And it's quite extraordinary how the mind just wanders off, wanders off, wanders off. And you have to bring it back and remember to practice this. So the first step is a practice. The second step is to get some sort of memory device to remind you what you were practicing. If I didn't have that, I would forget. I go blank. I just have no idea. What was I supposed to practice? It's amazing, isn't it? It's only the most important thing in the world. And yet the mind just wanders off the reservation. So it's an eye opener to have this discipline and say, okay, today I'm going to remember to practice this all day long, and then you find out how difficult it is. And you need this mnemonic device. It's like, oh yeah, okay, spirit of abidance, spirit of abidance. Thank you, Longchenpa. Spirit of abidance, spirit. That's what I really want. It's what I really want is the spirit of abidance. That's what we all really want. And so I'm just reminding myself, this is what I really want. And yet, the thoughts, the train of thoughts, wander off on tangents continuously. I say, what are you doing? This is what I really want. I should be able to be focused on this all the time. It's like, So, it's similar to physical workouts. When you're feeling strong, you get into certain practices and you realize, hey, I can do this. This is great. But after maybe the third, fourth day, you practice it really strong, and then you might feel really tired. Like right now, I feel really tired. The last couple of days, I'm exhausted. I'm shaking. I probably exercised too much, and I got sort of a inflammation reaction, generalized inflammation reaction, which is not a good thing. But I found out that I can do these exercises, so I was really, really excited. This is great. Wow. And you maybe pushed it too much. I don't know. But the same thing spiritually. You find out, and you push it, and you think, oh, that's great. I'm doing great. I've got it. And then you hit this wall, and you're just like, oh, I'm so stupid. I can't even remember what was I doing. So this is the difficult part. And this is the part that you just have to soldier through. And a nice mnemonic device. You have to come up with something, and I came up with one. It was grace of God helped me with it. And I just so all day long I could just spirit of abidance, Longchenpa. So Longchenpa has told me he's going to fix my spirit of abidance for me. This is what the gurus can do. They can do anything. They have no limitations. You just have to ask them. They're really ourself. The Longchenpa is what I am. Without belief. That's all. There's no difference. There's just one self. We're all that. And it's just, without freedom from belief, that's what it is. It doesn't have any belief. Doesn't need any belief to be what it is. So I'm just asking myself to help myself. That's all. What's wrong with that? Of course we can help ourselves. I see all these people, and the way the talk is, so few rely on the guru on Facebook. It's about what I have to do. I have to do this. I can do this. This. Blah, blah, blah. What are they thinking? Just ask the guru to fix the problem. That is yourself. Ask yourself to fix the problems that you have. We don't do this. That's because the dance of continuity fear. We know that would work. We say, no, we can't do what works. Scary. Success is scary, isn't it? Of course it is. So Longchenpa will fix this problem. Myself will fix this problem. And you could call it a problem, but you need the spirit of abidance. Not just... to abide, you need the spirit of abidance. You have to be in the spirit of it, in the mood of it, feeling that this is what I want to do. I feel the spirit, motivating me. The desire to do this has to be there. Otherwise, it's just a stale intellectual exercise, and we won't be able to remain in abidance. Abidance is remaining, means remaining in it. So I asked him to fix it. He said, I'll fix it. He fixed my golf swing after 44 years of futility, trying everything under the book, everything under the sun, everything in the book and more. I've tried thousands of different swings. I mean, just constantly tinkering. I was just constantly tinkering with my swing, and because it, I never felt like that this is it. I said, I just don't feel like this is really it. So I asked Longchenpa finally fix it. He fixed it in 10 minutes or so. I mean, just real boom, 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 boom. Try this. It's like, wow. That's got that feel that I'm looking for. That it has everything I'm looking for. It's easy. So ask the self to resolve the self's the issues we have. What could be more obvious than that? Doesn't matter what name you give to the self. It's all the same. Brahmana, Jesus, whatever you want to say. It's just the self. Christ Jesus. I mean, Christ, our true nature. Christ this, Christ that, Christ that. The formal name of somebody walking around here. Christ Jesus. Jesus is the name that was given to him. And they said Christ Jesus, meaning the one who was showcasing natural mind, true mind, natural mind, reality, showcasing it to us here. It's the same self. We're all Christ. We're all the natural mind. Okay, so just ask in whatever way you want, whatever you feel comfortable with, that's fine. And then prepare to succeed. So I'm working to prepare to succeed. I'm going to have this problem fixed. All I've ever wanted to do is simply to abide. That's it. But I haven't been able to get that spirit of abidance that's needed. Same thing, like example, the parallel of the golf swing. I just wanted to hit the ball the way I knew it should be hit. You know, I know I could do it, but I just. You know, what is it that's gotten in the way? I don't know. Well, injury. A lot of it has to do with injury. I thought I found something, then I would get injured. And I can't do it anymore. I said, wow, that strains this too much, this too much, this too much. And it felt awkward. You know, it felt like I was trying against some resistance. And whereas what Longchenpa gave me the swing, it doesn't feel that way. And so far, my body reacted to it fine. I just been working out, simulating this motion to try to get stronger at it, and I feel, you know, I just feel tired. I talked to some workout guy today, and he said, "Oh, it's fine. I mean, feeling real tired." Yeah, he said, "I feel real tired right now." I said, "You need to let their body give it a rest. Give it a couple of days. Let the body recover." So that's good for you. That's actually good. That's what you want. That's great. Okay. It's spiritually, it's very similar. You make a lot of brisk, fast success, and then you will feel like, wow, I don't know what to do. I just feel out of it. I feel so out of it because your expectations have changed. Yeah, on Facebook, people get into this groove of expectations of just, you know, the same old kind of quotes that just pretty much say the same thing. Okay, this is what I expect. This is what happens. And they just, you know, that's not quite it. Prostrating is that the Holy Spirit's always giving us the next shift in expectations. Whatever it may be, I don't know what it will be. I'm open-minded to it. You know, I don't have an agenda in terms of what's next. I don't know. Same thing with the workouts I've had. The Holy Spirit's always given me the next thing to do. I said, hey, Holy Spirit, I've been doing this other thing really well. And the Holy Spirit will say, well, yeah, but how about doing this well? I said, oh, what? Hopping on one leg? Come on. Yeah. Ah, it's terribly difficult. Yeah. I feel like I'm out of shape. Yeah. I don't know if there's anything more difficult than hopping on one leg, especially like on a trampoline, to wear you out. And but I'm improving, but I'm tired. It gets you really tired. So the Holy Spirit showed me this is what the grace of God wants me to do. Hop on one leg. And I actually hopped along a road or a pathway for quite some distance on one leg yesterday, then came back to one on the other leg. And it's like, whoa, you know, this is amazing. You don't see that very often, do you? Because it's so difficult. But it really causes your entire system to shift your expectations, really. It's an expectation shift. Just try hopping on one leg. And this is what tires us out. As we think, no, I got this, I got my exercise, I'm fine, I'm a jogger. Really try jumping all over a trampoline on one leg. Oh, can't do it. It wipes me out. And so we tend to keep going back to what's easy for us. As I said that the great athlete Laird Hamilton, the great big wave surfer, he says, look, the key to success is you keep throwing different exercises at yourself that you're not used to. And this is what I adopt, you know, I adopted this, and this is what has happened. Every time I get grooved on something, the Holy Spirit says, here, do this. And I say, that's really difficult. I don't feel like I can do this. It's, wow. And there's a steep learning curve to it. So the spiritual path is the same. The Holy Spirit keeps throwing different stuff at us. And we say, wait, I'm really good at, you know, looking at these pictures with quotes. I'm really great at that. I got to do something different. Oh, man, this is really tough. That's why, you know, gurus are very helpful. You hear about, you know, what they do, and they keep, you know, say, well, yeah, you're good at that. Now it's time to do this. And it causes a problem. You know, jumping on one leg is a psychological shift. It's just like you're not used to it at all. And so you kind of want to say, wait, no, what am I doing? So doing new things, which is what I've been doing the last couple of weeks. Every day I do so many new things I haven't never done before. I did a night lapse taping last night. It didn't work out well. I didn't realize that it just takes individual pictures. It doesn't put it into a video for you, which I think is a big mistake. And then having to edit it was a big problem, because 12 megapixel pictures, so many of them, it was just overwhelming for editing program. This didn't show the stars anyway. It showed the moon, but it there's not. The stars don't show bright enough here because of the ambient light of the huge, huge suburban complex here. But that was a first. So every day I'm doing many, many, many firsts, and it wears you out because you don't know what to expect. So what's going to happen? I don't know. I've never done this before. Now, when we're kids, we're it's so exciting because we have all this energy. But later on in life, you kind of want to set into a routine. And say, no, I know what to expect. But when you really want to succeed, you have to go back to being like that kid and say, let me try this. And it really, it takes a lot to do that. It really does. And doing things in an unorthodox way is very stressful on the psyche. We don't realize just how conditioned we have become, which that's the goal of this world, is to condition us so we believe there is a world. Yeah. So of course most of us believe there's a world, and because I'm acting like there is. I'm acting like there are conditions. Keep in mind that the gurus, that there's no limitations on the Dharma Kings at all. There's no conditions for them whatsoever. And there really isn't for us either, except we believe that there is, so we pretend that there is. It's these beliefs hold us, you know, hostage, really. So I'll keep trying to try new stuff, and just taping out is difficult, and find a lot of challenges to work through all of that, and setting this example. To don't be afraid to listen to the Holy Spirit and take the guidance. I got very strong guidance today. I wanted to take a GoPro video of bicyclists going downhill, so I came to a stop sign, and sort of a blind corner, and suddenly there's this bicyclist going on the sidewalk. So I said, okay, I'm waiting for the traffic to clear. I said, okay, but I was out a little bit in there. They had to cross a street. I was everything I did was perfectly fine, but the bicyclist, the conditioned existence, it didn't want to go around the front of my, front bumper at all. And like you have to do. I mean, if you're going on a sidewalk, a bicyclist, it's a blind corner. I couldn't see, and they have to obey the rules of the road too. But no, I was in their way, and they wanted to go in a straight line right across the road to where the sidewalk started again. And so he had to go around me, and he was yelling, cursing me as he did. Just, really, I had the both windows closed. I could hear him. He was fuming mad, like, what are you doing? You're in my line. It's like, but I didn't get mad. I said, "What does this mean?" And then I said that, "Hey, don't mess with bicyclists. They can get very uptight. Don't bother trying to record them." So I didn't. Otherwise, I would have tried to. So this is the Holy Spirit just showing me, just drop it. Forget it. You don't need the aggravation. It's I don't want you to deal with that right now. So I just didn't do it. So the grace of God is always available to us if we're just willing to be aware of it. And whatever anyone does, take it in as the Holy Spirit speaking to you, actually, because it is. So instead of like, yeah, getting whatever it is, don't get angry. Just say, "Oh, thank you, Holy Spirit. What, you're warning me about something. You're trying to get my attention. Okay, what is it? Oh, I see what it is. Thank you, thank you, thank you." And it was protecting me, because trying to chase the bicyclists down the hill, they go too fast, and I'm feeling very groggy and sleepy and having a hard time staying awake, and I'm not driving that well. And trying to chase a bicyclist down a winding, very dangerous road is an extremely dangerous thing to do. I mean, you really have to be super alert and on top of the world. And even then, you can't keep up with them. They go too fast. They're trying to go as fast as possible. So it's just a stupid thing, a dangerous thing. The Holy Spirit was just letting me know, "Hey, don't do that." So the guy helped me out. He was cursing me, and he helped me out greatly. So thank you. Someone curses you, thank them. Jesus says, love your enemy, bless your adversary, agree with your adversary, meaning listen to what someone is telling you, is the Holy Spirit getting your attention. It's amazing the faith-based life, believing in the grace of God, the Holy Spirit, grace of God, Holy Spirit, guru, is essential for liberation from continuity fear. Continuity fear is the only problem we have. We don't have any other problem. We don't have a world problem, time problem, space problem, none of this stuff. We have a continuity problem. That's the only problem we have. And so it's essential that we have faith that our self, our true self, which is what the Holy Spirit really is will help itself get free of belief, of continuity fear, really. Will help us evaporate continuity fear, because then everything, we don't hold on to anything anymore, and it's gone. We're not asking it to be there. We're just asking it troubles to be there for us, because we're afraid of being without them. We're familiar with having them, and we don't want to be without them. We think that's part of our identity. So continuity fear problem is the only problem any of us have. That's it. If without that, we'd all be completely liberated this instant. Everyone, without any exception to that. So the only problem there is continuity fear problem, and we need what's called faith in the grace of God. We need that to evaporate the continuity fear problem. Things have just gone a little strange here, as they often do. And I was listening, someone had a radio on, and I walked past the room, and there's this lady on a woman on there, and an educator, and she was talking in this very teacherish way. They were interviewing her, and she was giving the remedy for the troubles of the world, and she's just telling how marvelous, she's educating these refugees, educating this, doing this, and she said, "I am absolutely convinced that education is the solution to all our problems." It's And this is what educators believe. And But what's happening in the world is we're being led away from deep trust in the grace of God, the Holy Spirit, the Guru. We're being led away from that. We're being distracted away from that. And we're being taught to demonize it, to not believe in it, to think that it's a sign of stupidity, ultimately insanity, mental illness, and all this kind of stuff. There's this gigantic worldwide campaign to turn us towards education in how to, quote-unquote, fix the world. In other words, how to fix illusions. This is the wrong path. Okay, it's 100% wrong path. It's not an equal path. It's the wrong path. Okay, very cut and dried. As Jesus has pointed out, he says your problem really, what you're doing, what the mistake you're making, let's put it this way, the problem is continuity fear. And the mistake, the reason why we're not evaporating this is because we're trying to make illusions real and then fix them, you know, do something, make them better. He says this is your great mistake. And it is. It is. So the world is involved in this very great mistake called education. Fixing the world, making conditions better, materialism, it's called, and dressing that up in spiritual clothes, okay, clothing, and then calling it compromise or calling it good. There's no compromise. It's entirely the wrong way to go about it. And makes it things worse, actually. It just kicks the can down the road and makes it worse. Continuity fear gets even more intense. So, the grace of God, Holy Spirit gurus are very much aware of this. Very, very much aware of this. And from their perspective, it's a crisis. Because once we lose that deep, deep trust in the grace of God, then we are truly lost. We're truly in darkness. Because the continuity fear problem is a very severe problem. And we need the type of help that we need is the spiritual path of one of great faith, great trust in the help that we're receiving, and willing to try it out, accept it, accept the evidence. And you know, there's a lot to it, and this is historically, this is how we've done it. And people now, they think that no, with technology, you know, the learning, what we can learn is so much that this is certainly the way. It's not. So the gurus, Dharma Kings, are very aware of this, and they say there's a crisis. So who am I to disagree with them? Everything I see certainly correlates with what they say and backs it up. I don't know for sure myself if indeed there will be a crisis, but I'm saying certainly the direction I can see, when they say it's a crisis, nothing I can see to, you know, disagrees with it, actually. I say, well, yeah, it certainly does look like it. The problem, as I've said, is coming from the left, what we call the left, the progressives, who believe that education is salvation, and that we just simply educate everybody and we'll all be happy. Of course, they're the educators. What they're really trying to do is defend themselves against awakening. They say, if I make everybody is worship absurdity like I do, well, we'll be protected from letting go of absurdity. This is what they're actually saying. We're all foolishly absurd. To be here is to be foolishly absurd, unless you're a Dharma King to help is helping us out. But otherwise, you know, we're foolishly absurd, actually. Believing in time, space, process, and form, everything, all belief, believing in belief. It's so utterly absurd, actually. So we need to repent and admit that I've been very, very used to silly absurdity for a long, long time. And so I have a very severe continuity problem with truth. I keep going, lapsing back into worshiping silly absurdity. So the idea, the progressive idea is let's all worship silly absurdity, and that'll be that. That's it. They want everyone to be like them, silly absurdists, and they haven't repented. So they say, "What? You know, I don't need to repent. I'm educated. I received an education that told me I don't need to repent. That only fools do that, and therefore, I'm smart. And I don't need to." You know, silly absurdity. And so the silly absurdists are very much in control. And the gurus are very much concerned about this. And I've told them, not that I need to, but I've prayed and asked for help. I say, you don't dare let the momentum, you don't dare let the deep trust in God's grace erode. It's already so eroded. It's an absolute scandal. But you don't dare let it go further like this. This is disaster. Absolute disaster in the world right now. The deep faith based mind, the deep trust, is essential to make rapid progress on the path. And what we're being educated to just go as slow as possible will stall out. And then start drawing, the illogic arises, the logic of absurdity then seems to be very, you know, logical to us. There's a whole logic of absurdity, which if you don't see through it, you get trapped by it. It's all absurd. But you start thinking, well, which part is more absurd, which is less absurd, and you start drawing these meaningless distinctions, and you get trapped in this, what's called, you know, people call it the ego, the small mind, whatever, the false self. You get trapped in this making meaningless distinctions, and that's all you're doing. You're just spinning your wheels. When you're making meaningless distinctions, we're spinning our wheels. So we have to repent. The repentance says, hey, I've got a really severe problem, silly absurdity. I've been spinning my wheels for so long. I need, you know, all the help I can get, and I need to trust in something, and I need the evidence, and I need to really, when I get the evidence, I need to trust in it. You know, have faith in it. When I lapse back, when I have this wow reaction, I need to have enough trust so I wow it instead of trying to analyze it. So faith allows us to wow our progress. Trust in the gurus allows us to wow our progress. And in wowing our progress, we make very rapid progress. And in making very rapid progress, we're liberated from silly absurdity. This is how it has to go. There isn't any other way it has to go. You have to make rapid progress. You have to build your trust and faith and build your trust and build the trust. Otherwise, the stall out happens. You go back to what you're familiar with. This is just how it is. So to lose our deep trust in the grace of God means that we've just stalled out. And then we turn to silly absurdity to make us happy. It's like saying that the denial of happiness has to now make us happy. This is silly absurdity, right? Of course it is. But they just keep kicking the can down the road, say, no, you know, and they quibble, argue about the words you're using, labels. And it doesn't matter what labels you use. It's still there, right? Dissatisfaction. Denial of reality gives a feeling of dissatisfaction. So you have to drop the denial of reality. And they quibble over words. You know, it's so absurd. As if somehow that saves them from needing to do so. Like what you're saying, you're contradicting what you're saying, or blah, blah, blah. No, see, they lack faith. They lack trust. So I don't have this problem. I understand words are awkward. The fact that words are awkward doesn't mean that truth is awkward. Or it doesn't mean what the gurus are telling us is awkward. They're completely clear about it. It doesn't mean that they're somehow fuzzy and hazy about it because the inherent fuzziness and haziness of words, they're using words because that's what we demand it. That doesn't mean they're fuzzy about it at all. It doesn't mean they're oscillating. Their mind isn't oscillating. Confusion is oscillation. And the mind that's denying reality is confused. It's oscillating all over the place. It's trying to draw distinctions between, you know, within absurdity. It's like drawing distinctions in regard to zero. What else can you do but oscillate and therefore be confused? So we have this feeling of confusion, really. Fear, confusion, oscillation. And the spirit of abidance is the willingness to not have any oscillation. So it's peace of mind, you could call it. Not oscillating. But as soon as you use words, people will say, well, yeah, what about this word? How about this? In other words, their habit of oscillation kicks in. They're not good listeners. They don't understand that you have to have faith and trust of who's speaking so you don't go into oscillation. You go into the wow instead of into oscillation. So wow is a willful determination, decision to not oscillate. Do not allow your reactions to oscillate. So I have enough faith in the gurus to practice the wow. It's difficult building up that faith. Very difficult. The world always tries to oscillate. If you tell them anything, they'll try to get you to start oscillating, and then you get all nervous, confused, because they quibble about words. They shoot you questions about what about this. The whole purpose of it is to get you to oscillate, so they feel comfortable. Like, oh, you're doing the same that I'm doing. Therefore, what we're doing must be right, which is again silly absurdity. Right? It's like two people are starving to death. They say, well, you're starving to death, I'm starving to death. Well, that must be right then. This is obvious silly absurdity. So the idea of misery loves company. This is what happens here. So I tend to not tell anybody that can talk back to me about what I'm doing, because every time I have in my whole life, almost every time, there's some exceptions. Some of you watching the videos are exception to that, and you can feel it right away. Is they don't get stuck on words. You just briskly, agilely move past the words and get the essence and gist of it. And it's a beautiful experience because it's so rare here. So I thank all of you for that. It's very rare. Most everyone in the world. Immediately you feel yourself getting stuck in their oscillation, and they just want you to oscillate like they do. They don't want your certainty. They don't want it. And so I tend not to say anything to those who... And on Facebook, one good thing about Facebook is you have to be diplomatic, and don't throw oscillation at people too much. They're not there for that. They're there for reinforcement. They want others to like what they say, basically, right? So if you point out an alternative perspective, they don't really like that. That's basically don't disagree. If you disagree, just don't say anything. But and if you like it and say, hey, that's great. So you have to be very diplomatic, which is fine. It's good to practice being very diplomatic, because it's necessary in this world to be very diplomatic. People here are very nervous, very jittery. Their continuity fear makes them very, very jittery. If you're not oscillating like they are. They don't want to say, what's wrong with me? I mean, one of us is kind of out of whack here, and it must be you, like that. That's why it's important for the therapist, to have the prestige. So if you just say, no, the therapist is the same as the inmates in the insane asylum, you're not going to get anywhere. Here comes the doctor, the white coat, the authority, the prestige, and the patient. Everything's set up so they realize that, I need help. Here's someone to help me. I'm not where they're at right now. I'm oscillating. I'm lost in making meaningless distinctions, and I'm getting fixated on this. And as it inevitably happens, if we try to make meaningless distinctions about zero, we will get fixated into mental illness for sure. For sure. We avoid it for a while. We think we're avoiding it for a while, but we're kicking the can down the road, and eventually it gets us. Eventually it gets us. For sure it will. So everyone's in that same boat. Eventually you're headed towards, mental illness. There's no question about it. And it wouldn't be helpful to say otherwise. You end up saying, I've got to find something meaningful difference here about of zero. And therefore, I got to grab hold of this and this and blindly, and you get more and more blind and desperate and compulsive and fixated. And then you just try to put it together and hold on to it, and thinking, you know, the tighter I hold on to it, the more true it is, you know. And then you become really weird, and you enter into all sorts of various mental conditions, they call, you know, mental illness, psychoses, split mind, you know, all sorts of stuff. It just, you become very brittle, very weird, very frightened, very confused, and then thinking the world's paranoid, persecuting you, hoping that everybody else is like you, and that means that you're okay. So the world that attacks authority, that knows what those who know what they're talking about, tries to denigrate them, they're not doing anybody any favors at all. You have to have trust, faith, deep faith, deep trust, that the grace of God, there is a grace of God, and the grace of God knows what it's doing, absolutely, and does help us, is with us all the time. This is essential to avoid severe mental illness. It's essential. It doesn't prevent you from returning to this world. That in alone, you have to be skillful and reach, have this spirit of abidance. You must ultimately reach that. But it certainly helps you move you in that direction, even, you know, some faith. So a lot of, in history, a lot of people avoided severe mental illness because of their great faith, great trust in God, trust in the Guru, Holy Spirit, however you want to call it. They're able to, they're very, you can tell that there's a different feel to them, right? Faith-based society is a different feel to it than the compulsive, materialistic lack of faith, faith in fixing, you know, science, mathematics, let's fix, you know, let technology, production, distribution. Oh, the only problem is, we don't have enough things, you know, so we, you know, get it on Amazon right now. We got it. Okay, now I've got that thing. And that society, you find massive mental illness coming up, massive pharmaceuticals right now. It seems like every other person is on some sort of, you know, medicine to deal with psychological problems. And I do know what I'm talking about. I've been through it all. So, the crisis is this, what you might say, the progressive belief system in the world, is where the real trouble is. The real trouble is, and it's very bad trouble. The more conservatives, people, you might call them conservative, they want to conserve the older ways, which is what faith-based society. Very simple. You can talk about God openly. You can talk about your faith openly. You can bear witness to people. This is the type of culture I want to live in. And this, the culture, is being absolutely destroyed. It's wonderful on Facebook, the Indians, they're more open. They can talk about their faith and their trust in the gurus and such. It hasn't been, you know, completely destroyed there. But there's so few Americans. It's just astonishing. So few Western people. But it's beautiful to speak to the Indians and share your faith with them. And we speak the same language, you know. They can speak with me. I understand exactly what they're saying. They understand what I'm saying, even the language barrier. Because we're talking about trusting in the Guru, the grace of God, and our lives, how our lives work in this way, and how we're moving towards liberation. And they understand. They say, yeah, that's what I'm doing also. This is what we've been doing for so long. So, super gurus, the Dharma Kings, what are they going to do? They're going to do something. Ananda Maima is going to do something. Okay, I've talked with her, I've asked her, I told her, I said, I know you're going to do something. She's told me she's going to do something. I don't know exactly what, but She let me know she's very aware of this. And this is indeed a drastic situation. All the Dharma Kings are aware of this. You cannot part ways with your trusting in your inner faith in the grace of God. If you do that, if you lose that, then you are free-falling into mental illness. Okay, you're free-falling into mental illness. And of course, the progressives say, don't worry. We've got all these chemical companies pumping out pharmaceuticals for you, and they'll fix it. They'll fix any problems you have. They'll fix it. Just, we got to keep educating you. Yeah, but I know I'm feeling suicidal. I got all this anxiety. No, don't worry. We got this. Take your medicine and go to class and be more educated and more educated. You know, and the people are now, they're just so brittle that they then demonize any talk of grace. It just sends them through the roof. Because they feel so disempowered. Any talk of empowerment, you know, terrifies them. Any idea that they may not be empowered frightens them. So the more disempowered you feel, the farther you get away from grace, the more disempowered you feel, the more those who are with grace, the more scared you are of them, the more you demonize them and project, more paranoid you become. So, in other words, you're a mental patient. And mental patients need therapists. Okay, but when society decides that the therapists are the bad guys, and they're the ones who are crazy, then it doesn't work anymore. The world doesn't work. Okay, it doesn't work. It's headed for really severe problems. So I try to support all gurus and therapists and pat them on the back. Thank you for helping. And into their colleagues. Okay, so I'm very supportive. 99.9% of the time, even the ones that go rogue, I still, you know, they're still a colleague. Okay, they may have had some troubles, and that can happen, but we still appreciate the overall desire, you know, to promote faith and grace, etc. You know, were they saboteurs? You know, I'm not willing to say that. So we stay within grace. Okay, but we're not, you know, we don't let a rotten apple spoil the punch at all. Whereas the lunatics, really, the silly absurdists say, you know, one rotten apple, let's get rid of all of you. That's a lunatic saying that. It's like saying, okay, so one rotten therapist. Oh, all therapists must be rotten. Then let's get rid of all of them. And then they say, well, if there's no therapist, we must be fine. Right? So even you're in an insane asylum, those are in there. They really do believe that they're fine, but the therapists are crazy. And if they just get rid of all the therapists, then everything will be fine. That's what they believe, actually. And so this is on a collective scale. This is what the world is trying to do. And now, what choices do we have? Well, those who are therapists, they can't allow themselves to be pulled down into this belief that they're the ones that are insane. Because then there's not going to be anyone to help out. So, therapists have to be protected from this. There's no way around it. This is how it has to work. Otherwise, the whole system will just collapse, you know, and will go into, you know, a very, very dark situation, which you have to come out of that. Again, we just wasted, you know, huge delay. It doesn't help anyone. Doesn't help anyone. You know, this momentary belief, hey, we got rid of all the therapists, so we must feel, everything must be fine then. That doesn't last more than just an instant. Until they say, wait a minute, this feeling's coming back again. What is this? Oh my gosh. Yeah. It doesn't work. So, gotta protect the therapists. There's no two ways about it. And so I don't know what's going to happen exactly, but we may very well, the therapist may very well have to take a vacation from this world. As this revolution, you know, there's this insurrection is happening here, really. This temper tantrum, it happens. The tech people came in, and they're the ones that are really responsible for it. Brought in this arrogance, you know and people now are, you know, stirred it up, and this is was expected. Jesus knew all about this, that there is this tech sector in the cosmos who and this does go to the planets and contaminate them, stir them up, lead them away from grace. And Jesus knew this was going to happen to this planet. It's called the end of the age, and this is what would happen. And he told us what he was going to do, which is to come back to this world at that time and invite us to go to his world, this other dwelling place he's fashioned for us. That's what he said he was going to do. So we know what Jesus said he was going to do. And what about the other Dharma Kings? Well, I'm sure that they have also plans to help us out as well. So now, the last couple days, I mean, I'm aware of these very strong indications that we're getting real close to a crisis here, and really have to push forward. No doubt about it. So the Tibetan, for instance, Longchenpa, is indicating that we're just about there now. I mean, so he's saying, gotta push it. Spirit of abidance. I need spirit of abidance. The spirit of abidance. I need that spirit. And he says, I'll fix that. I'll give it to you. No problem. I say, okay, let's do it. We got to do it. That's how severe the crisis is. The world is already so detached from grace and trusting in grace that at any moment it could just collapse into this very, very nasty, nihilistic, mental diseased condition. Many are already very much there. The collapse of all authority, then they can run amok. They can really run amok. And they may very well do that, run amok. Once the idea is, hey, the therapists, they're the crazy ones, and so let's run amok and get rid of them, and then we'll feel fine. You know, that's the mentality they have, actually. They're really lunatics, I have to tell you. It's not a joke. It is not a joke. And there's still this old structure of authority that they're trying to destroy, and they think that's their salvation. And the authority came from what? The saints, the sages, the gurus, the avatars, the saviors, the enlightened ones. That's the structure of authority. That's where it came from. In other words, those who knew what they were doing. Those who were free of belief, free of the belief in conditioned existence, who free of arrogance, free of trying to change what they are. Those who accepted the moment. That's where the old structure of authority came from. And it's been termited to such an extent that any day it could collapse, actually. It could be demoed, you know, any day. It could be tomorrow, actually. So we have to have the spirit of abidance is essential. The spirit of abidance, spirit of abidance, spirit of abidance. The willingness, the spirit to do this. A willing spirit for abidance. Spirit of abidance. When you want to do something, isn't it easy to do it? When you really want to do it, you know, just like you're so into it. Yeah, you do it. And it doesn't feel so difficult. You're happy to do it. It's joyful to do it. So this is fun. I enjoy this. I'm really into it. That's a willing spirit. That's a spirit, the spirit of abidance. So we have to really be into that. Say, this is what I love doing. This is what I really want. This is what I've always wanted. This is great. That's essential. It's really essential, the spirit of abidance. So Longchenpa told me it's time for you to have the spirit of abidance. Absolutely. You can't delay anymore. Gotta have it. So they're crystal clear about what's going to happen. And they have their eye on the whole world situation, how it's playing out, and the attempt to really separate us from grace, really, to distrust it. They're working so hard to get us to distrust it. And substituting, when we distrust faith and grace, the grace of God, we feel very discouraged. And what they do is they substitute sex, drugs, rock and roll, you know, that whole thing, for to try to treat the discouragement. All these, you know, all this stuff they use to try to treat discouragement. So, oh yeah, the flesh, that'll. That's what your problem is. You just need to indulge the flesh, and that'll get rid of your discouragement. What happens is you get even more discouraged because it doesn't work, and then you don't know what to do because you don't trust grace anymore. The flesh doesn't work to get rid of the discouragement, and so you just feel like it's hopeless. But no, it's not hopeless. Just go back to grace, trusting in grace. Oh, but I can't. You know, of course you can. But I said so many bad things. No, it doesn't matter. We understand. I mean, part of the situation is you're hoping that, you know, you can pull the therapist down to your level, and so then it makes you feel like, oh, I see, they're not any different than me, so I must be fine. So they're a therapist, I'm the same as them, I must be fine. No, but they've been pulled down, so being the same as them would not mean you're healthy, right? Of course it wouldn't. And they can't see through this absurdity. It's just absurd logic, actually. So again, apparently there's a crisis about ready to happen. It's a very severe situation. The Dharma Kings will do something. I don't know exactly what, but whatever they do is going to do, they'll protect our trust in grace. Now, Sri Sri Nanda, my mom, may simply appear in some way, may give indications that of her presence. She may start doing that, which is, you know, it's a game changer. Now keep in mind, she has no limitations, none whatsoever. She has appeared to various devotees after her death, just appeared to them and consoled them and helped them out and freed them from afflictions and troubles. She's not in any way limited by a body dying, passing away, her body passing away. She's not limited in any way. Of course, Jesus isn't either, but showing the resurrection, he said, I'm not limited either. These Dharma Kings can do anything they want to do. They have no limitations. They can appear anywhere, at any moment, and in any way, and to help us out. And you know, this may be the next step we need to take. I'm ready to take it. It's a big step, isn't it? That you realize they don't have any limitations, and therefore neither do we. And you think, well, I can never get there. No, I feel I can get there. Okay, it's just a matter of sticking with it, and you know, we'll get there. This is how I feel. We will get there. It's not unsolvable. I've seen how it's possible. It's just a continuity fear, you know, comes back in. That's all. Without continuity fear, we have no limitations either. Plain and simple. And I'm confident we can evaporate our continuity fear if we just keep working at it. Absolutely, it will evaporate for us. So, bring it on. Let the Dharma Kings do their dance. They want to break the mold and show up. It's time to break the mold and show up. You know, certainly this will cause us to reevaluate our expectations if Sri Sri Nanda Maimon just shows up. Definitely that will we'll need to change our expectations, just like Jesus showing up after the resurrection challenged us all to change our expectations, did he not? A supreme challenge, was it not? So we're in a situation where it's very possible the Dharma Kings will simply show up physically. They'll just appear, they'll be here. And in some way, they're going to show up, and we're going to say, wow, this really is great. This is really great. This is very helpful. Of course, this is going to cause quite a what's the words? Those who want to get rid of grace, this is really going to bring them out of the closet, so to speak, and they're going to say, you know, start insisting you're crazy. And you know, it's going to rattle their cage. Definitely rattle their cage. And we simply have to continue on understanding that, no, this is happening to those who are the therapists to protect them from the ravages that would be foisted upon them, or the world's trying to foist upon them, because it's necessary. Because when you get really severe mental illness, you're going to want a competent therapist. Even though you might be argumentative and you know, troublesome, you're still going to want it. And this is what the world's headed towards. And so, of course, you have to protect the therapist. And later on, you realize, oh, thank God they were protecting me. I mean, you will be so happy. The world will be so happy that the therapists were protected. Because they were wise enough to choose to be protected. You might say, I'm just wise enough to realize I choose to be protected. Absolutely. I can see the overall dynamic, and I say that's a no-brainer. Of course. So those who choose to be protected will be viable in down the road to help out. And at that point, those who are struggling to come out of their psychoses will be say, wow, how fortunate. Amazing. That's amazing. This is great. Wow, I really have a lot of my trust is returning from grace. And they have to get it back. They're hardly going to get it back if there aren't any gurus, you know. How can they get it back? It's pretty difficult. Spirit of abidance, spirit of abidance. I get off track, you're like the spirit of abidance. Spirit of abidance. So the Dharma Kings have their eye on the world very keenly right now. They notice everything that's taking place here. Their job is to protect trust and grace, protect the teachers of God, protect those who are willing to help out down the road. Right now, of course, there's a crisis in the world. Down the road, there will be great need for help. So, of course, they have to protect. But don't we know that the fire commander, battalion chief, protects the firemen that are fighting the fire? Of course, looks out after them, and he says, "Hey, I want you guys to pull out of that situation there. That's a dangerous situation. I can't afford to lose you. We may have to sacrifice that part of the house, building, to save the rest of the building." So the fire commander has to make these calls. Oh, you're out there fighting the fire, and says, "I got to save this." And if the fire commander says, "Hey, I want you to pull out, pull out, pull out," you got to pull out. So this is what we have to listen to. So let's use this analogy. There's this huge fire. Maybe it's even a city is burning. And the fire commander has got all this experience. And they're saying, okay, look, we've got to decide, you know, where we draw our lines. What, you know, how do we are battling a wildfire? Where do we, how do we cut this off? And what's the strategy to minimize the damage of this wildfire? And deploy the firefighters where it's most effective. And then when they say the wind suddenly shifts, they say, the commander knows that the weather report, they have to know the weather. And here in California, we understand battling wildfires, okay? So they're very aware of the advanced weather report. It's very important to know this. So is a marine layer coming in? Are all this, you know, Santa Ana winds, offshore winds, are, you know, the hot winds, are they coming? What's the pressure system? You know, the humidity, you know, how, you know, all this kind of stuff about the weather, and that factors in on what decisions do you make in terms of fighting this wildfire? Is the weather? It's very important. And then the brush, how dry it is, you know, a lot of factors go into it. And so when the weather suddenly shifts, the wind direction shifts. They have to anticipate that and be ready for it. And if you have a bunch of firefighters and suddenly the wind shifts, you may have to get them out of there in a big hurry. And let's say the fire's advancing one direction. You've got all these firefighters working on it, trying to, you know, control the blaze. And you get this weather report. You say it looks like in a couple of days there's a danger of the wind might suddenly shift directions and blow real strong. There's a pressure system coming in from north, and that's going to cause. And you see it. And you say, wow, I better get all, you know, the exit routes cleared. I better have the trucks and the machinery to evacuate. If this is what happens, it's likely it'll happen. So let's have all the evacuation ready to go. And if it doesn't happen, fine. We'll keep battling the way we're battling. But if there's a high probability that it will happen, shift like this, then we better have all the evacuation ready to go. Because when a fire shifts, like suddenly shifts, the wind shifts, the fire can turn on you and just engulf you. And this is what you have to avoid. So the wise ones with a lot of experience and wisdom, they're aware of these advanced metrics in terms of conditions. They have to be. And make precautionary plans for that. So, say with the Dharma Kings, they have to look at this world. The winds here are the winds of belief. Okay? And how those shift around. Egoic consciousness, you know, is a very fickle monster. And they have to be aware of those who are trying to help, you know, cool mental agitation down here. Cool it down, really cool it down, and lead to liberation from belief. They're deployed, and they know, hey, things could turn real nasty here, and at that point, may need to evacuate. So I just have faith that if there is some need to evacuate, they have it all planned out ahead of time. Have to. I mean, if a fire commander would have it all planned out, of course. You would too if you were a fire commander. You'd make sure you get those bulldozers, make sure the roads, make sure you can get out if they need to get out. So they can flee. Make sure that the vehicles are ready to go, gassed up. And enough vehicles are there to take them out of the front lines if it gets too dangerous. You can't afford to lose a lot of firefighters in a fire. They don't want to lose a single one. They're very, you know, so the Dharma Kings are, you know, immeasurably more keen than the finest fire commander. So they know exactly what needs to be done. And I'm getting the impression that the winds are about to shift here. May need to beat a retreat. Now the ones that are on the front lines are so committed, you know, they want to show how committed they are. They don't want to back off. They say, no, I'm willing to fight this fire to the death. You know, well, yeah, but the commander says, no, 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 I need you. I don't need you to sacrifice yourself in a hopeless situation. That's stupid. When I need you to shift over here and let's go on this flank, and you know, I can deploy you in a way that's going to help bring the fire under control. But right now, this area where you're working at need to be redeployed. So there may just be a redeployment happening soon here in the world. We'll be redeployed in some way. I'm not making any headway on Facebook at all. None at all. I've made great efforts there. Just, you know, there are few. There are few but as far as making headway, no. As far as building momentum, as far as helping fight the fire, no. No. I thank those who do, you know, like or comment and say this is helpful, but not very few have said, hey, I really like this. This is actually helpful. And there's a few, you know, that understand what's going on, but most, no, they just ignore it. You know, it's amazing. I throw Longchamp out there, and nothing, yawn, nothing. Wow. I throw, you know, whatever I throw out, it's like water on a fire, and the fire just rages on. It's you know, it's burning too hot for the water to do anything. And that's how it is. I don't know. I just have put a lot of effort into it. And, you know, I could throw out 50 posts of just high quality, other than the few. No indication they even looks at it. I mean, I try to like people's comments and like this, let them know I'm looking at it. And I tend to comment. Thank you. That's really great. I really appreciate it. That's very helpful for me. I find if it is, they could make a comment. Let them know that what they're doing is making a difference. But there's always these clicks, you know, and they're just used to just autopilot. Like, okay, like on this. Whoever, if someone, you know, a paper poster, whatever they post, okay, like. You can't seem to make any headway. It's bizarre. It's really bizarre. And I get a lot out of it, because I get a lot out of anything, because I'm putting a lot into it, focus. But as far as fighting the fire, you know, it doesn't. It's not working. So at least I tried. You know, I've tried everything. I've tried YouTube. Tried Facebook. Tried social media. That doesn't work. It doesn't work. So there has to be something else that works. And our education has been such a miseducation that we don't know how to listen to authority, spiritual authority. We don't. Jesus understood this by bringing the Course in Miracles, as he realized that because we're educated morons, silly absurdists that think they're smart, that we're not willing to listen really anymore to anyone other than each other. Like, you went to college too, you have the same education. Okay, I'll listen to you then. It's like that. Well, these gurus didn't go to college. Oh, I won't listen to them. No. So we value our own educated absurdity so much. You know, the clothes we've dressed silly absurdity up in so much. We won't listen to anyone else. So he brought in A Course in Miracles that is designed to help those who are caught in that trap begin to make progress, which is to relate with one another, forgive one another, this idea of forgiveness. And it's a way to move past this trouble with our education. But, you know, most everyone that I've come across in A Course in Miracles, they're all educated, highly educated. Most, you know, have degrees. Most are professionals. They're all of this ilk, which I'm not welcome in that group at all, actually. And they all think pretty highly of their intelligence and their education, and you know, they're sort of, so that they're all this clique, you know, this big clique. So Jesus is helping them out in that way. Well, that's just one way. I mean, it's a way of dealing with a very difficult situation. If you don't value education in the world like myself, then I can go, different way much, very rapidly, actually. Because I don't have a degree, I don't have a profession, I don't have anything. I don't value any of that at all. And so I'm like a renunciate, ascetic. It's just the world. I don't find any value in the world. And so I could talk with anybody. It's just a matter can someone wow what's being said? That's all. That's all that really matters. But no, the educated people, they have to answer back and say, well, I see what you're saying, but let me correct you here on this. And they have to prove, they have to stand up for their education. And that just gets in the way entirely, doesn't it? They say, well, I can see how you dressed up absurdity that way, but I think maybe dressing up absurdity this way makes me feel a little more comfortable with silly absurdity. I say, no, that, no, you're missing the point entirely. Wait, what are you talking about? You just can't get anywhere. So it's better to let those folks work it out, with among themselves. Among themselves. And apparently Jesus says there's a way to do that, so he's helping them out with that. But that doesn't mean that guru yoga is passé, not at all. It just means that we're so stuck in valuing education that we're not even able to benefit from guru yoga. We're lower down, with a slower path. Guru yoga is a fast, very fast path. And those who value their education are not able to go that fast. They keep getting in their way. Their self-concept, of how educated they are, keeps tripping them up constantly. They're just stumbling along. Yeah, it's horrible. So those who are not so encumbered can go to Ramana directly, just listen to what he says, and just wow. And Ramana is just fabulous, actually, so fabulous. And just everything he says is just like solid gold. It's just, I just sit there and just go, oh my gosh, oh my gosh. Wow. Like that. He just don't say anything. He just quiet mind. Just wow. You know it's true. What he's saying is true. You know it. It's absolutely true. And trust it. The more you trust it, the more you just wow it. That's it. You don't. No response arises so much unless it's just yeah. I mean, my responses are like, thank you, Rabbi. That is so wonderful. This is just, this is just. So super positive responses, like, oh gosh, this is just, yeah, what you're saying is so true. I can see it. Thank you. Just like that. But even within that, there are cliques that form in terms of they think, oh well, we've been with Ramana so a long time, so you can't know what he's saying like we do. That's not true. That's not true. Who can judge the speed? If they just because you've been with someone a long time doesn't mean you're going really fast. I had this situation, a dream with Sri Sri Nand Mai Ma. I think I've said this, where I found myself in a room with her, and there's all these devotees, and then she called me up to her and treated me like, like she'd known me like long time, and treated me like I really knew what I was, like some senior devotee or something, and all the devotees look at me, say, who the heck is this? We don't even know who this is. He hasn't spent any time with you. How could you be treating him like this? And she says, look, here's his resume, his spiritual resume, and showed everyone, and showed me. He's like, wow. And she says, "How do you don't know how long he's been with me? You know, just because you're with me physically doesn't mean I'm helping people out all over the world, and you know, he may have been benefiting from me for a long time and going really fast. You don't know. The guru knows." So if you come into a clique, you know, they say you're a newcomer. They assume, well, you're not up to speed. you know, some, maybe some aren't, maybe some are. You just have to read the room, read the room. But, you know, it's like school, all cliques that formed in school, right? The same thing. It's just the same spiritual cliques form, all this stuff. Yeah, it's a dance of continuity fear. And you just have to listen to the Holy Spirit, listen to the grace of God. So I don't know. I'm not exactly sure what to do. Facebook, it just doesn't seem to. I don't seem to be, you know, helping out hardly at all, really. And it's really about practice. I mean, you have to inspire to skillful practice, managing success skillfully. If you don't do that, you're just going to stall it into a click. Have your little group and you know, and say, okay, we all kind of are stalled out the same way, so that means it's not a stall out, right? Same old problem. So let's just define it as good, and it's good. That's our happiness, sure. We're all stalled out together, so we call that happiness, so that should work. No, it doesn't work. When we believe, we feel this dissatisfaction. This dissatisfaction we feel is we're denying what we are, trying to deny. And we're not satisfied with that. And so this deep sense of dissatisfaction, that can never go away except by accepting what we really are. That's the only way. It can't go away just by redefining your unhappiness and calling it happiness. That's madness. It doesn't work. Obviously it doesn't work. And yet we keep hoping it will work. It obviously can never work. So we just have to then, you know, but since we've lost our faith in grace, we think it has to work. Except we got nothing else except let's play with definition. You know, argue about definitions. It's so silly to argue about definitions, to argue about words, isn't it? It's so silly. Different Indians use different words or stuff, and I just have to roll with it, you know. And we could, for the most part, we understand what they're saying. Even if we're using different words, we realize we're speaking to the same grace. You know, we both have faith in the grace of God, and that's what's important. And we don't get caught up in arguments. I like the way the Indians tend to disagree with one another. There's sort of a gentle way that they say it that's not offensive. They're very diplomatic about it. And they're just saying, yeah, look, we got to have more faith in grace, and the gurus will help us with that, and we know this is true. And so, it's a gentle way. It's kind of coaxing them, but hey, you know, don't get too far off the reservation. They're responding to, of course, materialism and the various isms that are sweeping through India, trying to, you know, erode their faith. And I like the diplomatic way that they speak. I'm benefiting from that. I look at that and I say, wow, I would have responded in a different way, but they responded but of course they're responding in a culture where they don't need to be so strong in their statements, because they just kind of gently chide their brothers. Hey brother, you know, you're straight into materialism there. We know that's not the way. Let's have faith in our teachers, and that's pretty much all they need to say. Because then the others will say, oh yeah, okay, you're right. Whereas in our culture, you know, you have to be way stronger in admonishment, and you have to say, you know, you really got to push it, because they're just going off the reservation like crazy. Gentle reminder doesn't seem to work very well. No reminder seems to work well. So maybe I have to stop hitting my head against the wall. At this point, it doesn't work. And I may, you know, end up getting too adamant, you know, fighting the fire of forgetfulness. I may just have to back off, because the Indians have this gentle reminder and they don't get all stirred up themselves. And I like that. They have a lot of faith, a lot of them still, because they have reason to have a lot of faith. I mean, you have Sri Sri Anandamayi wandering around your country for 86 years. You're going to have a lot of faith. That is for sure. You're not going to easily abandon that. Deep down, you're going to say, no, 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 I'm not abandoning that. I met an old lady that had met Sri Sri Anandamayi here in the United States, here in California. I looked at her and I said, you know what? I think that you met Sri Sri Anandamayi because I can tell. You got some kind of faith in you, deep kind of faith that must have come from her. And she goes, you know, you're absolutely right. That's exactly what happened. Saw her one time. I never forgot it. It stayed with me my entire life. This is why I still have so much faith. My whole life, she changed my life, she said, into one of deep, deep faith and trust in the grace of God. And it's never left me, she said. It's never left me. And she says it never will. So these materialists who think that we're going to drop our faith, you know, they're barking up the wrong tree. And they don't understand that at all. They simply don't, because they ignore all the evidence, right? They ignore it. So they've ignored, for instance, Rama Maharshi, Sri Sri Anandamayi. So they think that we just need, we're suffering from a lack of education. No, they're suffering from ignoring the evidence. So, you know, if someone just refuses the evidence, you have to say they're kind of suffering from a silly absurdity, right? So, you know, we're the therapists, and they're the ones who need the therapy, and yet they see it completely opposite. So I'm not going to drop my faith. It's not possible. It's not possible. If you really experience, for instance, Sri Sri Anandamayi Ma, the way I have, you cannot drop your faith. You know, it's even though we might be frustrated because it's mysterious, faith seems to be mysterious. You know, you can't drop your faith. You cannot. Same with Jesus Christ. Same with Rama Maharshi, Longchenpa. Longchenpa is proving himself. They all keep proving them. Grace keeps proving itself. And the materialists just assume that if they push us hard enough, we'll drop our faith. But how many Christians have been martyred throughout history? You know, what is it, 100 million or more or something? I mean, it's an incredible number throughout history of people who refused to drop their faith in Jesus Christ, and they went to their death because of it, because the materialists insisted, well, if we just push you hard enough, threaten you with death, you're going to succumb. And they said, no, we won't. And so they suffered death at the hands of these maniacs. And they did not recant their faith in Jesus Christ. But the materialists always believe that they're the ones who are going to get us to recant our faith. Every crop of materialists always believe they're the ones that the ones before just weren't didn't have the right stuff, weren't stern enough, weren't, you know, thorough enough, something. But this crop will certainly get them to drop their faith. And so we have the same old scenario right now in the world, exactly the same as it's ever been. We got this massive crop of materialists, and they're very confident that they're going to get us to drop our faith, and it's not going to happen. You know, they should study. They don't even study history. They're just so arrogant, they're so full of themselves, that they think, they don't even say, I don't need to study history. It's failed every single time. Say, no, 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 this time, you know, we're so superior, it won't fail. No, it's already failed. They don't understand, it's already failed. We don't need to hang around for their tantrums. It's failed already. So, you know, why hang around? The verdict's already in. Failure, another failure. Failure. Materialists have failed again, as they always will. They don't even know what they're up against. And they're all, so, you know, they're going to be all confused and upset and says, how did I fail? How come I failed? I need more education, you know. No, you need to come across the saints, the Dharma Kings. You need to start looking at the evidence. You need to start experiencing the evidence. And you need to stop calling these inner experiences or glimpses of reality, you know, stop calling those mental illness and trying to treat it and realize, oh my, instead saying, hey, this is a breakthrough, I need to wow it. That's the way to mental health, is wow your way to mental health. That's the entire key to it all. So when I had these experiences, I wowed. I said, wow, I'm just positively stunned. Okay, great. I have to recover from this. This is shocked. Sri Sri Anandamayi shocked me very severely, to say the least. Still shocks me severely, as does Ram Maharshi. Just to see them. There's no words. There's no words. Just shock. Super positive shock is all it is. There's no. She has no limitations. For instance, there's no limitations there. None whatsoever. And that's so shocking. She's got to be the most shocking guru in history. I mean, I just she is so shocking in a super positive way. It's just, she knows everything. Nothing escapes her attention. There's no limitations at all. And this is ourself. This is what we are. This is what we really are. Sri Sri Anandamayi is really ourselves, ourself. That's what we are. And I know this to be true. So it's quite shocking. I cannot, split my mind and say I'm a materialist and this is someone different and special, like the Christians say Jesus is special. No, Jesus is us. Jesus is what we are. But he tried to tell us that. He told us this. What I do, you most certainly do. And he said, you're the same. We're all the same. This is what you really are. Yeah, that's quite shocking, isn't it? The difference is, for us now, we have video and pictures of the 20th century, the ones who came, like Ram Maharshi, Sri Sri Anandamayi. We could see. We could say, oh my gosh, this is what I am. I'm just so fabulous. I thought I was this wretched human being, but I'm really this fabulous spirit with no limitations whatsoever. I'm just this. What I am is completely beyond words, beyond concepts. I'm just so limitless. I'm so free. I'm so unaffected by dreams. She was so unaffected by everything in this world, had no effect upon her. Nothing that happened in this world had any effect on her whatsoever. Didn't even touch her. And that's me. That's what I am. That's what you are. This world really doesn't touch us at all. So that's very shocking. And yet it's true, and so we have to get used to this, progressively used to it. Now, of course, it's quite difficult to accept we have no limitations at all. And she literally, just extraordinary, the detachment from this world and a detachment from the belief in limitations. And how at ease she was with it all, and just laughed. Yeah, doesn't know any difference between pleasure and pain, what the body feels, etc. No distinctions, no identification with the body. Didn't even use its senses to perceive at all. Actually, she said, I don't even use the eyes to see at all. For me, at nighttime, it's not dark at all. It's the same light as your daylight. Same thing. I don't use the didn't use the senses to function at all. Didn't even need to eat, actually, or sleep, anything like that. The body didn't really have any needs, but she pretended it did just to calm us down, because otherwise we'd get too nervous, So she pretended to have limitations, but it was only a pretense. And when she didn't, when it was necessary, helpful to not have limitations, boom, no limitations. You could see instantly no limitations. She'd be sitting in a room one place and she'd appear some other place, help someone out. Wherever she needed to appear, she'd just appear. She'd be there. A lot of times she'd drop the pretense to limitations, and there were no limitations there at all to her functionality, none. That's who we are. That's what we are. That's what we are. And so we have, you know, the road, the path is to get used to this and accept it. Accept the fact we don't, we too have no limitations. We don't have any. We don't have any. Never have had any. We've never had any limitations. It's not a matter of getting free of limitations. That's the lie. That's the dualistic lie. And many people call themselves non-dualists, and they're dualists, plain and simple. We've never had any limitations. We've never been born into any conditions at all. There are no conditions. There are no limitations. It's 100% pretense. We're pretending, completely pretending. Okay, that's all we're doing. That's all we've ever done. So drop the pretending, and that's it. But it's a big pretending, isn't it? But so what? It's a big pretending. It's still pretending. So let's not try to draw meaningless distinctions, you know, in this pretense. It's all pretense. That's it. Nothing more that we need to say about it, really. Oh, how are we doing here? Very great. So I'm back taping like I'm used to taping. I've been trying to figure out, how can I use this GoPro? I don't know. Maybe the whole purpose of it was just to show me the limitations of it. Probably that's what the Holy Spirit does a lot of that. Says, yeah, try this. This is great. I say, oh, but Holy Spirit, you know, it's not so great. And the Holy Spirit says, yeah. But you thought it might be, right? I said, yeah, you're right. But now you know it isn't. I say, yeah. I said, oh, thank you. It might be helpful. We'll see. I feel more in my element at doing this sort of taping. Of course, I've done so much of it, and it's smooth, it's clear, it's wonderful. And maybe some of the other stuff can help us feel like, you know, we're not really, we're still with it in terms of the world. We can still be with it. You know, those who think we're crazy, those who follow grace, we don't want to seem, as they keep trying to push us into this hole, you know, we say, no, I can still function this way. I can still do this stuff in the world. Like, you know, I'm still hip. I'm still cool. Because there's a great effort to make us feel like we're not, right? We're really not at all. And we can overcompensate trying to prove to them that no, I can still pretend to be human. They're afraid we'll stop pretending to be human, you know. And so we overdo it. We get caught up in overdoing it, just to sort of, you know, calm them down. Calm the inmates down, you know, the ones that are really, you know, rattling their cage and screaming, like, hey, don't stop pretending. He says, well, you know, time is here to stop pretending a little bit, you know, and he might get a little bit agitated, but, you know, I can't get caught up in this trap that's coming, so we'll have to drop some pretense here, and down the road, you'll be happy that we did that. I wish I could stop pretending to be tired, though. That'd be a good one. And that's actually a pretense of trying to convince, help reassure everybody that, no, I'm just a human. I get tired, too. It's a pretense. Everything is a form, time, space, process, and form. It's total pretense. None of it's ever happened, actually, at all. When you're pretending, it's not really happening. And this is something that people have trouble understanding. It's not really happening in the way that we think. We think something's happening to us. Nothing ever happens to us. And pretense could stop instantly, and then that's the end of it. It vanishes without a trace. And everything is this way. It all will vanish without a trace, like it never was. And it never was anything external to us. And it never affected us in any way. You know, the person who was pretending, I've got a hoarse voice, or I can hardly talk like this. You drop the pretense, and you realize instantly, you realize, I never had a hoarse voice. I was just making it up. I was pretending. Gone without a trace, because it never was. This is true non-duality. So true non-duality is really different than all this stuff you read in Facebook and stuff. You know, they water it down too much. They water it down too much. Ramana doesn't water it down. I love Ramana, what he said. But it gets, you know, they spin it. They don't understand that what it's really saying. All this is just pretense, because the continuity fear says, no, some of it's real, some of it's real, some of it's real. Yeah, I can understand you saying some of it's pretend, but there's some other stuff that isn't pretend. That's duality. And they try to dress it up. I try to tell them, no, that's duality. They don't like it. I mean, I try to be diplomatic, but I could tell, freeze up. It's like trying to pat a chicken. Hi, chicken. I thank you for laying the egg. They get a little jittery there. Oh, speaking of that, did I? Okay. Wow, I just reminded myself of something. Okay, very great. I got to go. I gotta put some chickens away. Very great. That's it.